Well, welcome to 700 Club Interactive. In the English language, we use the word love a whole lot. We love our new car, we love our flat screen TVs, and we also love our spouses.
But with so many uses of the word, has love lost its true meaning? Recently, we asked some of our viewers how they interpret this infamous word. Take a look.
I think love changes. As people grow, their hearts grow and their lives change, and in return, their love changes. And, you know, it's good. Love changes, though, definitely. Definitely changes.
I have to say no to myself every day so that I can love my husband better.
Trust, bro.
Communication, like big time communication about everything, I think.
After the feelings of butterflies go away and you're done just dreaming about the person every day and night and you're over the initial I'm in love phase. I think love happens when you make the decision to love that person after that goes away. So it's not just a noun or being in love, it's really a verb of actively loving that person. Someone won't always be waiting to cradle you. Someone won't always be there when you need to be held. I won't always be waiting to cradle you, but I will always be there when you know where to go.
Can mean a lot of things, not just like one scenario of love or just being with a boyfriend. But if you love something so much and we only have this one life to live, why not passionately just dive into it and just drown and just sink into it? Love is crazy, so just have to be violent with it.
At first, when you see someone, you're drawn to them by how they look or how they act. And then you keep being around them because they're fun to be around, because they make you laugh or they make you happy. And then trust, I mean, like, I trust you enough to be gross and wear sweats and stuff my face around you because I know you won't judge me. That's what love is to me, just being able to be yourself around someone really, really, truly, and in a very raw way, be yourself.
Love, well, it affects us all in one way or another. And joining us now via Skype are the pastors of Mars Hill Church in Seattle, Washington, Mark and Grace Driscoll. Welcome to both of you. Thanks for being with us.
Good morning.
Thank you.
Will you talk a little bit about, your book is called Real Marriage, The Truth About Sex, Friendship, and Life Together. And we heard a little bit about each one of those things in the comments that were just made. What is your definition of love?
Well, we start in the book talking really about friendship, that the language of the Bible is that to be face-to-face is to be friends. And so one day we'll be face-to-face with Jesus as he's the best friend ever. And in marriage, we want to be face-to-face and friends with our spouse. So for us, we talk a lot about love equals friendship.
Your book is really candid about a lot of things. You describe in Real Marriage how many people need to, what you call, reverse engineer their lives and marriages. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, it's looking at the last day and deciding what you want prayerfully for your marriage and life to look like, and then planning that. We give some practical tips on how to make plans to have that life that God wants for you, that marriage that God wants for you that is truly loving the way God intended.
Well, Grace and Mark, we just heard people, as they were talking about what love meant to them, talk a lot about honesty. And you write that there's an absence of honesty in a lot, if not even maybe most, American marriages. Why do you think that is?
Well, we know that everyone's a sinner, and Jesus died for sin. And if we acknowledge that we're sinners, we can be honest with one another and know that Jesus died for sin, so we can forgive one another, and it doesn't need to kill our love, joy, and friendship. But I think sometimes shame overtakes people, and they want to hide, just like our first parents, Adam and Eve, did right after the first wedding. And the good news is we can come clean, we can be honest, and because Jesus died and rose, we can have a new marriage with the same spouse, even if we've been in a rough place.
Yeah, you know, I think a lot of people feel like, why even bring up the issue? I can just stash this in the past and move on from here. How important, in your experience, is being honest about past relationships or even mistakes that you've made in your marriage?
Yeah, love definitely is keeping no record of wrong. So we do need to move on at some point. But God asks us to bring everything into the light so we can have fellowship with one another. And so in order to do that, we have to be honest. And there's some hard things that might need to be discussed in order to have that honesty with each other. If we're hiding things or lying to each other about things, that's not an honest relationship, and it divides. And the enemy definitely uses that to separate a husband and wife. And so we believe that through our experience, as we tell in the book, there needs to be an honest, hard look at a lot of things that have both happened to you, and looking at the way God loves us and wants us to be redeemed from it.
Grace, you talk in the book about being honest about some things that had happened in your past that were very painful and difficult for you. Did you find a freedom in that? When the light comes in, the shame goes. So how did that change things for you?
It does. It's a process. It's not immediate. It feels immediately like a weight has been lifted because you're not having to hide behind the shame anymore. But it does take time for that to work itself out and to communicate through that and learn how to communicate as we did through that and learn how to love each other and appreciate each other and just walk through the pain from past.
How did you make each other feel safe enough that you felt you could do that about things that had been shameful or a weight in your life?
Yeah, we tend to be real honest in the book, and the hope is that if we're honest, that'll help couples to be honest as well. And for us, it really does come back to an abiding belief in Jesus, that he loves us and gives us love to share. He forgives us and teaches us how to forgive one another. He's a good friend to us and teaches us how to be friends with one another. So I'll be really honest and say, if Jesus wasn't in the center of the relationship, it wouldn't have worked, and it certainly wouldn't look the way it does today. And we're good friends having a good time.
How important is respect in a marriage relationship?
Very important. It's a command, but in Ephesians, we're supposed to mutually respect each other, but the woman is the helper and is to respect her husband. It's important because we are created to do that, and if we aren't respecting each other, then we're not loving each other the way God asks.
Mark, you say that in the book that you needed to be tough, but also tender. Was it that tenderness that gave your spouse the ability to be honest and free about who she was and what she was feeling?
I hope so. I say that for the men, we need to be tough and tender. Jesus was both. We need to be tough to protect our families and make sure that they're not getting used and abused. We need to be tender with our families, loving and encouraging. Some men are only tender and they allow other people to harm their family. Some men are only tough and they're the ones who harm their family. So, yeah, I'm trying to grow in the grace of God and want other men to pursue that as well, to be tough and tender. And I hope that makes Grace feel protected by me, but also loved and safe and cherished in relationship with me.
Well, here's something that might surprise some of our viewers. You say a good marriage starts by being friends with benefits. Explain what that means.
It's friend with benefits, because it's only one friend that gets
that. Take that ass off of there, Terry.
But that is the context of safety as well that God intended for marriage. That one friend that you can share everything with, good and bad, for better, for worse, rich or poor, as the vows say. That friendship is key to being able to build a relationship that actually has some content to it, some depth to it. If you don't have that friendship, it makes it a lot harder to work through just the day-to-day things. And so we've really worked hard to build that friendship and make it a focus of the book, because you want that as your basis to be able to work through the rest of the issues in your marriage.
Well, I want to tell people about the book. Mark and Grace, thanks for joining us today and for your candor. You have lots of wonderful information and advice. If you'd like to know more about Mark and Grace Driscoll and the book, which is called Real Marriage, you can go to 700clubinteractive.com. By the way, this book is available wherever books are sold. If you're struggling in your marriage, even if you're not, you just want to have a better than just good marriage, get a hold of the book. It'll really help you with that. Coming up, a love story that overcame poverty, sickness, and a drought in their nation. All of that after this.
Hi, I'm Valerie Bertinelli, and today we've been asking what so many women would like to know: how Cindy Crawford seems to have defied the aging process. She's 43 years old, and she looks like she hasn't aged a day in years.
She's proud to say, I am 43, and I look great. And we all want to know, what is Cindy Crawford's secret?
The secret to Cindy's ageless skin is French anti-aging specialist Dr. Jean-Louis Sabag.
Dr. Sabag is one of the most sought-after skin doctors on earth, with models and VIP clients who flock to him for his exclusive treatments and formulas.
Now, in a remarkable advance, Dr. Sabag has infused the powerful melon extract at the heart of his treatments into an anti-aging system called Meaningful Beauty.
Ever since I first started using Cindy Crawford's Meaningful Beauty, my skin feels firmer, lines are less visible. Now, how would you like to see results like that for your skin?
And now you can, because Cindy has made it so easy. Normally $119, but order now and pay just $39.95. Plus, for a limited time, your shipping is free.
My skin is much tighter. There's obviously something in this incredible melon that makes our skin look younger.
Watch as over time, an ordinary melon decays, while this melon stays amazingly youthful and preserved.
Each day using Meaningful Beauty, I feel younger and younger. Pores are going away. Fine lines are disappearing even more, to where I don't notice them at all.
Order in the next 4 minutes and receive bonus gifts worth $50. Plus, order now and your shipping is free.
Hey, I'm almost 50 years old. I don't expect to look like 20, but I'm feeling pretty darn good about how my skin looks and feels.
So call now and get the magic of Cindy serums for your skin. Call 1-800-799-6939. That's 1-800-799-6939.
Grab your phone, make the call, and get the skin you've always wanted.
Well, we want to show you an unusual love story from a village in northern China. It's about a country boy, a city girl, and the gift that changed their lives.
Bu Yi was born and raised in a remote Chinese village. He left home and moved to the city for work. And that's where he met the girl of his dreams, Liu Qing.
And Liu Qing told me it did not matter if I were rich or poor.
Or blind in one eye, Bu Yi was injured in a farming accident. No surgery could repair his eye or fully restore his sight. But that didn't bother Liu Qing.
His kindness impressed me from the very start. So no matter what, I made up my mind that I would marry Bu Yi, because I loved him with my whole heart.
Liu Qing's parents opposed the marriage because Bu Yi was so poor. But the couple secretly said, I do, and moved back to Bu Yi's small village. The newlyweds and the people there were facing a growing water shortage. That made washing, cooking, and farming difficult. So every morning at 5 a.m., Bu Yi walked 2 hours to collect water.
I worked very hard to fetch water for my family, because we cannot survive without it.
After pouring most of it on their dry fields, Bu Yi and Liu Qing had very little left to drink. Ultimately, Bu Yi got sick, and he was unable to work the fields or carry the heavy water jugs for his wife.
My husband had worked so hard over the years that he just could not go on.
So Liu Qing began to go and fetch the water in her husband's place.
I did not want my wife to make the journey because it was long and hard. I told Liu Qing that she could leave me, but she said she never would.
When CBN learned about Bu Yi and Liu Qing's situation, they decided to help them, as well as other members of that small community. CBN built cisterns at every home, beginning right in the young couple's backyard.
I was so excited when I saw CBN building a cistern in my yard. My father took the first sip of water, and my wife put together a big celebration.
Today, Bu Yi is healthy and back to work. Now, neither he nor Liu Qing need to walk for hours to collect water.
Now our future is bright. I never worry about water anymore. Thank you, CBN. I regard the cistern you gave us as a great treasure.
It's hard to imagine that kind of deprivation and need for something as simple as just water to drink when we have it so readily available to us here in the United States, isn't it? What's wonderful is the solution isn't difficult. It just needs people like you and I to step up and say we're willing to make a difference. That's why we invite you to join the 700 Club. It's 65 cents a day, $20 a month, and you join with thousands of other people who are out to change their world with the love of Jesus, telling people about his love, but in practical ways as well, changing their lives by providing something like clean drinking water. If you want to be a part of touching the world in this way, call our toll-free number. It's 888-777-1999. Just say, I want to join the 700 Club. We welcome you as a part of an army of people, really, who are reaching out to the world with the love of Jesus. You can also join with us by logging on to CBN.com. Well, coming up, what's it like to be married to the frontman for one of the biggest bands in Christian music? His wife says, bumpy. Find out what kept their rocky marriage together when we come back.
It's been a year now, and what do the Tea Party freshmen in Congress have to show for it?
They have done one thing. They've changed the discourse, the rhetoric in Washington, to talking about making cuts.
They have, I think, held Boehner's feet to the fire.
You're not going to turn things in Washington, D.C. on a dime. But as I said, the conversation has changed.
Checking the report card on Tea Party Freshmen on the 700 Club next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
The group Sanctus Real started 16 years ago when a couple of 10th graders got together and formed a band. Led by singer Matt Hammett, they released a string of number one hits and became one of the biggest names in Christian music. But while it looked like Matt was a big success, life at home was a different story.
Marriage started out as an adventure for Sanctus Real's Matt Hammett and his wife, Sarah.
The first 4 years that we were full-time on the road as a band, Sarah was with me.
We had a lot of great times. I would say our relationship grew immensely, but resolving conflict on the road was really difficult.
We really didn't have much privacy. And it really, I think, caused us to not have healthy communication. And because of that, I think we would kind of bottle up a lot of our feelings, a lot of our frustrations that we would have, it can kind of cause a passive-aggressive type of communication.
Life changed dramatically for the Hammetts when Sarah got pregnant with their first child.
I remember being in the back of a Chevy van in the way back where there's no seats, sleeping on a sleeping bag 6 months pregnant and bouncing around and just thinking to myself, I can't do this anymore. So that's when I threw in the towel and I stayed home from that point forward.
It was hard to change our life like that. You know, it was hard for me not to have her on the road anymore. And it was hard for her not to be out seeing new things and meeting new people.
It was also difficult for both of them to adjust when Matt came home after the baby was born.
The hard part about traveling all the time too is that when you come home, you literally just want it to be perfect because you dream of getting back in your house, seeing your family. So you always want to make the most of the little time that you have. The expectations for me were that I would come home and it would just be a place of rest and refuge.
I had the mentality like, my time's over and you're up. Like, you gotta do all the grunt work and it's your turn.
I walked through the door with both of us having great expectations on each other. And when we felt that disappointment and then we started to vent our feelings and our frustrations, it'd be really easy for those arguments to get out of control, for our emotions to get out of control really quickly.
We had expectations that seemed logical and acceptable to have towards each other, and then we would fail each other, and then we would grow bitterness and contempt. And it was so deceiving. It really hit itself well, because it's really hard to call out your own contempt for someone because you feel you have a right to it.
It got to a place where the cycle that we were in of arguing just felt like we just could not get along.
Matt and Sarah were committed to making their marriage work, so divorce was not an option. They laid aside their bitterness, went to counseling, and tried to take ownership of their faults, but Sarah still felt something was missing.
We were starting to make changes, and I said, that's fantastic, but I really need you to, like, be the leader in our home.
That was the day that God just used her specific words to really break my heart and to really seal inside of me what he'd already begun in terms of just teaching me to be more teachable in terms of the kind of man that I am, the kind of leader that I am for my family. That day that we had that conversation is the day that I sat down and looked around me. I looked at all the pictures in our house, and I looked at the pictures of her smiling and our kids smiling. I looked at a photo of our wedding day, and my heart really ached because I felt as though I hadn't seen that glow in a long time. And I just wanted it back so desperately, and just cried out to God in that song that afternoon.
Lead me with strong hands, stand up when I can't.
I started expressing her heart and what my kids might say to me one day if I'm not a good leader to them, and really expressing my heart to just be the kind of man who fights for my family, and not by fighting, not by being stubborn, but fighting by just laying it all down at the feet of Christ and saying, Lord, you know what? I'm weak. You're strong. Every breath is just gonna have to be grace from you to be this man. The whole song, Lead Me, about being a leader is ultimately in the end saying, hey, I can't do this by myself. You know, I'm leading my family by saying, Father, lead me because I'm not capable of this.
Even just that understanding, once somebody says, I know I'm this way and I really do want to change, that really helped us move forward when we finally accepted our weaknesses, even though we thought we were all along.
Today, Matt and Sarah's marriage is stronger than ever. The relationship was tested again earlier this year when their third child, Bowen, was born with a serious heart defect.
I think feeling like we were in a really good place in our marriage and we're learning how to deal with that conflict better it really prepared us because there's so much stress in having a sick child.
There was a purpose for what we went through, a God-ordained purpose. I believe it, and he's pulling us through it, and he's showing us his grace. And now I think when there's conflict, we understand that, you know, there's hope here. There's a purpose. It's not the end of the world. We can work this out. And it gives us that much more hope and that much more fuel to just keep working through it in ways that glorify the Lord more and more. It's just God's grace. In our weakness, he's strong.
In our weakness, he is strong, but it requires us to remember that we have a weakness. Sometimes you can be in very public ministry, but at home, with all the pressure, you take it out on the people that are closest to you. And you need a mirror to look into and really see what you're doing. And it can be more than just in public ministry. It can just be in everyday life today. More and more Americans are saying how stressed out they are and how there's no time. And they wish there were more time for the children. They wish there was more time for the spouse. And they're just not taking the time. But it requires that to say, okay, his strength can be made perfect in my weakness. And with that acknowledgement of your weakness comes the humility you need in order to be teachable. Why did Jesus tell to us that unless you're like a little child, you won't see the kingdom of heaven? Little children take instruction. They understand that they don't know everything. Now, occasionally when they're 2 years old, they want to say a lot of no. And we can be just like that and say a whole lot of no and not realize that God is trying to lead us in the proper way, to show us the good way, to show us life, an abundant life, not a life of strife, not a life of, you know, what are we going to argue about today? Not of fear, am I doing enough, am I being enough? But he wants to show us the perfect way. And what it takes on our part is the humility to say, I'm weak. And God, Daddy, I need you, and I need you right now. And I need you to show me the way. I need to learn how to speak the gentle word that turns away wrath. I need to know how to humble myself and ask for forgiveness and ask for restoration. Because if you do that, well, then your marriage can work. And it's not some conflict, and it's not who's going to win or who's the boss or who can assert themselves the most. No. It's all about who can give themselves the most. When we read the Song of Solomon, we understand great wisdom. Sometimes in marriage, just like with the Shulamite, we start off with, my beloved is mine. And we take ownership of them as if you can own them. And we start talking about all the great gifts that they're bringing to us. And it's only at the end of the song that we really get the message where instead of saying, my beloved is mine, we say, I am my beloved's. I no longer own myself, and I give myself freely to them. And then the great mystery, and their desire is towards me. When you truly surrender and surrender to one another, that's when you see the great blessing in marriage. If you need help in your marriage, if you want someone to pray with you, all you have to do is call us, 888-777-1999. And if you want more information, we've got this wonderful booklet for you called Love and Marriage. We'd be glad to send it to you free. If you call us right now and give us your email address, we can just email it to you so you can have it right away. If you don't have an email, great. We can always mail it to you the regular way. Love and Marriage is yours free when you give us a call. Well, we've got time for an inbox question. Comes in from Kay and says, my husband and I have been married for 20 years, but a few years ago we began to have problems. During this time, he became close to a female minister. I felt the relationship was inappropriate, but he only saw her twice a year for conferences. Recently, I was out of town on business, and while I was away, he had a 5-hour dinner with her. I called her supervisor to complain about her behavior, and my husband is furious in anger. He has moved out of our bedroom and asked for a divorce because I wrongly accused them. What should I do? Okay, I'd go to him and ask for forgiveness. It'll start with your humility. Now, is a 5-hour dinner with another woman a proper thing? Probably not. But he's feeling offended. And one of the best ways to get through that is to just go and take the initiative and say, will you forgive me? That's all the time we have. We leave you this word from Colossians. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. God bless you. We'll see you again.